So here with Sarah Booker-Lewis, a local democracy reporter for this episode of The Vote. We're going to start off by doing this last show before Christmas. So by talking about Robert Nemeth, Councillor Robert Nemeth, Sarah.
Yes, Councillor Nemeth wants to see the Valley Gardens bus gates redesigned after tens of thousands of people have received fines. So this is a motion he's got going before full council this week, and it's seconded by Samir Begin. They're both members of the Environment, Transport, Sustainability Committee. So this is very much in their realm. So what we have is a situation where drivers don't seem to understand the bus gate system and the design and signs. And what Councillor Nemeth is asking for is a report to go to the ETS committee to consider the options for redesigning the junctions. Now, this is all Valley Gardens phase one and two. It had very extensive public consultation starting, more than 10 years ago now. And I went to an exhibition at St. Peter's Church myself and saw all the plans. So there is quite an astonishing number of fines. Something is not working. Now, I've seen a lot of people commenting. This story of mine appeared in the famous Angry People in Local Newspapers website over the weekend. And there is an image of Robert Nemeth standing by the bus gate with a big buses only sign and bus gate. So a lot of people that don't know the area were saying, why are people going through there? There's a big sign. It's written on the road. There's nearly £2 million in fines that this has generated. Something isn't working. And as well as the look at a redesign and something to try and make people aware of the way the road changes, Councillor Nemeth is also after a report to Policy and Resources about returning these fines. Now, people have broken the law, but is the road layout bad? That is the big question here.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, what was the reaction to that, to Robert's comments?
Well, we'll have to wait and see what councillors say on Thursday. That will go up for debate. I've just seen stuff from members of the public, from the people from the area are saying that they've been fined. They don't understand what's going on. People from outside the city, they just see pictures of him standing by these signs saying these are for buses and taxis and cyclists only. It'll be interesting to hear what other councillors say. Of course, when this was revealed, we had the quite shocking moment where Councillor Jamie Lloyd, the renowned cyclist, admitted that he has received a fine driving through the bus gates, but then he doesn't drive very often.
Yeah.
Interesting to see what happens on Thursday.
Yeah, so that's that one. Next full council meeting then. It's going to be an hour and a half meeting, I understand. Is that right? So it's all going to be slimlined down, stripped down.
Well, it depends what happens, really, and if this is agreed. I don't know about it being an hour and a half. That would be terrific. But what they're looking at is limiting the number of councillors attending the meetings to 40 in the light of the Omicron variant. And this is because and everything is going to be at Hove Town Hall at the moment. The council has looked at other venues. Brighton Town Hall, as we saw in October, it is very small. They can't fit everybody in there. They can't even really fit half the councillors in there. And other external venues are too expensive. I've spoken to other local democracy reporters who have had external venues used at their councils, and sometimes they're paying £10,000 for a night to have them. So, you know, that's just too much money. So what the option is having the public engagement as a separate entity with the lead members. And that would reduce time and have everyone separately outside of the meeting, but still public, and have it as a hybrid, or have the lead members in the chamber and the members of the public that want to come in and discuss, because these aren't issues that require voting. They do sort of sometimes require agreement if they want to put it forward to a committee, but it's a sort of like a safe way to reduce the meeting down. Now, yeah. One of the big things is petitions. If a petition has the threshold for a full council debate, that will still get debated. And there are currently three petitions up on Thursday, which are the school admission numbers ones that about 5,000 people have signed those. So that does need many voices. So this hybrid idea with the separate public engagement, that is proposed to run until May. and they're looking to suspend standing orders for Thursday. Now, with meetings, they want to keep them down to 40 members. Quite a few councillors have actually had COVID now, here and there, and I'm pretty sure most of them are vaccinated. A lot of the ones I've spoken to from all parties have had the jab. So that'll be quite interesting to see how they manage. It may well be that they will just stick to the motions on Thursday, but and also the important business that has come through from other meetings.
Yeah.
Now, Omicron has actually hit the housing panels this week. The residents, officers and councillors were supposed to be getting together in community rooms around the city, but that's going back to Zoom.
Yeah, and obviously Laddin's just been cancelled, I've just found out as well. So it is having an impact on the tourism industry as well and the hospitality industry, Sarah.
I was supposed to be going to see the Human League.
So I'm not sure about that, but I know Aladdin's just been cancelled, so yeah.
Oh, no, that is very sad about Aladdin, because, yeah, I mean, we all want to have a nice time at Christmas and go and see some shows and have fun. But, yeah, Omicron has hit quite hard. I do actually know someone in the city who has got Omicron, which came as a bit of a surprise. So there we go.
OK, so Greens then about backing the Conservative motion to restore council drop-in services or hit back at it, at least.
Not happy.
Yeah.
So this is that there are actually two motions the Greens aren't happy about. The first one being the Conservative motion to restore council drop-in services. This is from Joe Miller and Dee Simpson. They say that residents are very concerned about the drop in face-to-face services related to housing and parking in particular. Parking permits, I mean, that's been one of the big issues of the year. I still see people posting on social media every day saying, I need some visitors permits, or they're waiting for their permit. It's not as bad as it was in the late summer, early autumn, but it's still, people are worried about it. So Councillor Miller, he wants a plan on how services are going to go back face to face before full council. And he wants it to go before full council in February. So he wants the plan in place. Now, his motion was published before everyone was encouraged to work from home again due to Omicron. And now the deputy leaders, Sue Shanks, she chairs Health and Wellbeing, and Hannah Clare, who, as well as chairing Children, Young People and Skills, she is the council's customer experience lead. They're really unhappy with this Conservative motion because, as Sue Shanks has said, council workers have been working throughout the pandemic. It's just people haven't been able to enter the offices and see them. And there were initially issues with the telephones, but, you know, technology, it does allow you to change that now. But yeah, I mean, council services, they have continued, even though those doors have been shut to the public.
Yeah. So that's that. Labour Councillor Gary Wilkinson has motioned to sort out basic council services. I mean, they're pretty poor at the moment, aren't they? I mean, I know that the... you know, the waiting list for council repairs on housing is what's over 7,000, probably going to expand over the Christmas period as well. So there's big backlogs, isn't there? I don't think there's any argument there, is there?
No, I mean, the problem has been this is to do with social distancing, with the repairs backlog, because they couldn't have people going into people's houses. What Gary Wilkinson has said is that this is very much to do with the key performance indicators, like as well as the waste collections, the rubbish and recycling, the graffiti clearance, the parking permits, the weeds. Now, we're not talking so much about the weeds now because they're all dead. But, you know, come March, those weeds will be springing back up again. And this is another one that, again, Sue Shanks and Hannah Clare were really unhappy about, because... yes, people have been working. I actually had a chat with a council worker on Thursday morning. He was in Bevendean. He was sweeping up the leaves, doing a bit of weeding with his hoe. You know, the guys are out there, but how many of them are there? And how much area do they have? He did say to me that he was running behind this week because of all the wind and the rain. And, you know, it was different. Everything he did, then it all sort of like became undone as everything blew around again. So, yeah, I mean, people are working very, very hard, but the situation with the pandemic, with people being sick and all sorts of things going wrong, it's not really helping. So, again, This was Gary Wilkinson's motion that was supposed to go before October's meeting, which was the meeting abandoned because someone tested positive for COVID.
Yeah. Brilliant. We'll leave it there. That's Sarah Bucklehurst. Join us for the second half. I'll be back with Sarah talking about local issues. Join us then.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes. Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.
So back here with Sarah Bucklehurst, local democracy reporter. We're going to start off by talking about Sackville Road. I know there's some building works going on there, but also roadworks. It's a bit congested. I was up there the other day, top half of Sackville Road, pretty congested with the Sackville Trading Estate, or former Sackville Trading Estate building taking place, which I think is 1,000 units, housing units.
Yes, there has been quite a big problem resulting from concrete from the new mode of development in Sackville Road. MODA are trying to sort it out, but what has happened is somehow some concrete has ended up filling up the sewers there. That has caused problems with water in the area and, of course, the sewage system backing up. So Southern Water have had to carry out these emergency roadworks. So that's why a huge chunk of the top of Sackville Road is currently closed off, because they need to clear that concrete from the sewers. It's thought to have come from the weir washing system, because when these huge developments take place, there are agreements to make sure that the roads don't get covered in rubbish, dirt, concrete, etc. And the concrete dust is washed off the wheels, and so it isn't trailing along Sackville Road. But unfortunately, somehow it has ended up down the sewer. Now, MODA and their development team, they are really sorry this has happened. It's very unfortunate. There has been a rumour going around that someone dug into the sewer and filled it up with concrete, but I'm pretty sure that we'd see much more catastrophic level of roadworks carried out by Southern Water if that had happened, whereas, you know, a bit of a concrete berg. This is one of the reasons why people are advised not to put things like wipes down the toilets, because the things like concrete and kitchen fat, it clings to it all and it creates these huge blockages, and it really causes huge problems for Southern Water.
Yeah, what about we've got the kind of building works going on there as well. I mean, it seems to be going quite smoothly. MODA, the developer, seems to be working with residents, but it's a massive project there, isn't it? So it is. I know we've spoken in the past, it's really, really big, and I know that the I'm not sure if you're aware, but the Brighton Gasworks plan proposal has gone in as well for Brighton Gasworks. That's going to be a similar size project, I think.
Yes, I mean, that is a huge scheme. Now, yes. Difference with the gasworks is that requires a lot of decontamination, because even though there are companies based there, you've got the buses and everything, there will be stuff underground that needs digging out. That one's going to take a very long time. Whereas this development in Hove, it was just an industrial estate, so there isn't the contamination. So that's why it has really started coming up quite quickly. I can see that one of the lift shafts is already visible above the wall line there. So this all of the homes there are available to rent. So that's going to be quite an interesting addition. I can see the New England development, that's the Legal and General one from where I live, and the tower there is really starting to show up behind Vantage Point next to New England House. So that's again another rental development. So these are quite exciting things that are coming, and hopefully will have an impact to provide more housing for people. So yes, now the gasworks development, that has got quite a lot of opposition from local people under the umbrella of aghast because of the contamination. So yeah, it'd be interesting to have a good look through the planning application there.
Yeah, exactly. Rough Sleepers, just tell us, give us a bit of an update on Rough Sleepers, because I spoke to Jim Deans. I mean, it's a big homeless crisis, as we know, in the city. Jim Deans from Sussex Home Support has been talking about it, and the Conservatives have as well.
Yes. Now, Rough Sleeper numbers are going up again. I've actually got an inquiry in at the moment to establish that they are increasing. They're not up to the level that they were, but then the homeless count is of people who are actually seen to be bedded down for the night. So if you see a person who may be sitting on a sleeping bag with a cup in front of them asking for money, they may not necessarily be counted as a rough sleeper. They may have somewhere to sleep for the night. So it's a bit of a strange situation, but those numbers are going up. It was about 39 at the last count. So the Conservatives are asking for an audit of how all of the government money that the council has had in recent years has been spent in supporting the homeless. Now, this is going through, this is Mary Mears who's pushing this forward with support from Anne Meadows, the former Labour councillor who has also chaired housing. These two are two veteran housing councillors. They know the business. And they are very concerned in particular about people who are going into unsuitable accommodation without adequate support. Now, one of the places they cite is Kendall Court in New Haven. That has been a prime example of a place where there are issues. There are people who have died there. There are others who feel very unsafe living there. There are very few facilities for washing clothes. They're isolated from friends, family, and their general support network. They have to come into Brighton to get help finding jobs, getting their housing support. Even worse is the situation where there are out of area placements in Eastbourne. Again, people have died in Eastbourne. And I think most of us are very aware there was a woman living in a tent in Old Steen Gardens. And she was in that tent because she had left the accommodation she was put in Eastbourne because she felt very unsafe, that there were people there trying to sell her drugs, trying to lure her into prostitution. So they're asking for this full audit of the money and to try and find a way to get a proper 24-hour support in Brighton and Hove, not outside of the city.
Yeah. Hangleton and Portsay councillors as well, looking for a footbridge over Benfield Valley Park.
Yes, this is a bit of a joint thing between, it's Tony Janio that's putting it forward, but he does have the backing of the North Portslade councillors. Peter Atkinson is going to be seconding it. And the road in Benfield Valley, it is dividing the communities of Hangleton and also Mile Oak. I go down there quite a lot. And yeah, I wouldn't want to try and cross it on foot. But you know, if you're living in Foxway in Mile Oak, you might well want to just pop over maybe to have a pint in Hangleton Manor or a nice meal or something. And the idea of having to drive it seems a bit ridiculous. So what he would like to see, what they would like to see, is a footbridge over that road. Now, it is busy and something like that will cost money. Whether the money is available is another matter. And when it comes to crossings, it's always a case of special provision goes in when there have been serious injuries and fatalities. But no one really wants to even try and cross that road. So it's a sort of like a bit of an impasse situation. It'll be interesting to see how the debate goes and if maybe they can find the money to put the footbridge over there. Something like the one at Kingston Lane on the Shoreham Southwick border would work pretty well and allow people to just walk across between the two communities.
Yep. Lastly, school petitions about the PAN. Just tell us all about that. I mean, that's affecting primary schools, isn't it? And that's going to be a big issue in January 2022.
Yeah. I've spoke with parents and teachers and governors from four of the schools last week, and they are planning to hold a protest outside Hove Town Hall from 4 o'clock on Thursday. So the passion and anger in Woodingdean, Bevendean and Hollingbury in particular are incredible. They can't believe that they've been singled out for this. Now, a lot of these parents are saying they should have gone for the bigger schools. They should have gone for the city centre schools. But That is what happened last year. And I have heard, apparently, that Brunswick Primary in Hove has won its appeal not to have its numbers reduced. So I had a good chat, actually, with the two Woodingdean head teachers, Woodingdean Primary and Rudyard Kipling. And what they feel would work is if all of the primary school head teachers in the city were put together in a room and told, right, you need to cut your numbers by 500 by 2025. And they think that actually, if they all got together, they could come to some form of compromise. Maybe everyone cutting, or the two form entry schools or bigger, cutting by five, cutting by 10. That would sort of spread it out and it wouldn't hit them quite so hard. These schools have been offered, apart from Carden in Hollingbury, they've been offered to reduce to 1.5 classes, and they are really concerned about the potential of mixed age teaching, because it's not something that teachers are trained to do. It used to happen in the past, but back in the 70s and 80s, we didn't have the national curriculum, so you could sort of stretch it around a bit more.
Yeah,
it's passionate. More than 5,000 people have signed these petitions, so the feeling is very, very strong.
Yeah. Okay, we're going to leave it there, Sarah. All the best for a new year, and we'll catch up in 2022.
Remember, you can keep in touch with us on the various social media channels, Twitter and Facebook, by searching Latest TV. Plus, of course, you can see all our clips and get the latest news at our website, which is www.thelatest.co.uk. We'll see you in just a few minutes.